Welcome to the Wheelwright and welcome to the Ralph T. Coe Foundation. I'm Rachel Wixom. I'm President and CEO of the Ralph T. Coe Foundation. I have Bruce Bernstein here, who is our Executive Director and Curator, and Beth Murphy's over there. She's our Assistant Curator. We have several board members here, which I'm happy to see.
I'm going to be brief. I'm going to let Bruce do most of the talking today, but I just wanted to welcome you all. I hope you're on our mailing list. If not, let me know and we'll add you. We have quite a few programs coming up, which I will let maybe Bruce talk about. And with no further ado, I'll pass you on.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. We really appreciate it. And we'll try and keep it as a standing sort of talk, and we hope today it can be very chatty as well. So well, about 45 minutes worth and lots of time for questions. And basically, we've done these tours of the exhibition to try and give people the idea that an exhibition is not the final word, but it's just a beginning word. It's just a doorway into lots of other narratives and lots of other discussions, which was one of the most important things to who was the collector. Anybody know the collector's name we're working with?
Ted Coe.
Thank you.
I passed my test.
Anyone know Ted's real name?
Ralph.
Uh-oh, we got a tie here.
Was there somebody over here? Said
yes.
Okay.
I know. Did anybody
know
him?
Yes.
I won't tell anybody at all. There'll be other questions, I assure you. But one of the most important things about the foundation is its openness, and that it's not a museum, it's not a collection, but it's something that fits in between and connects all the different types of people who are interested in Native arts, who collect Native arts, who study Native arts. It's really a catalyst or a hub, and that's what we're trying to do. We're so happy to be here at the Wheelwright. This was a great opportunity for us. Jonathan Batkin, the director here, invited us to put on an exhibition to use the space here. We used their designer, who was fabulous, and we'll talk more about that as we go through. Today, we're going to talk with Scott Hale. Thanks, Scott, for coming. Scott is a scholar, collector, appraiser, nice guy, and taller than me as well. I asked Scott because of his different types of interests. It's easy enough to stand in here and for people like myself to give you the line, but I really think it's really important that we hear all different types of discussion. Now, I had formulated today's talk as three questions, and I put it on a little yellow sticky, and then Scott sent me two pages single space. So maybe we'll do the single space questions. But they're really basic questions. Scott was here, taught in Oklahoma, works here in Santa Fe, in Oklahoma, throughout the West, works with a number of institutions, helping them with appraisals, as well as identifications, and just a variety of things. I think you'll find it very interesting. So let me just give you a brief introduction about Ted. I know some of you know about him already. Hi, how are you? I know many of you, who knew Ted personally? Okay. You knew Ted?
I knew Ted. You missed one.
Did I miss someone who knew Ted? Do you know Ted?
Yeah.
You knew Ted? So yeah. Tell us a story about Ted.
Ted taught me about Chinese food.
Chinese is okay.
In Kansas City, right?
Kansas City.
In Kansas City, okay. So Ted started out life in the Cleveland area.
Really?
He went on to Oberlin and then Yale. He was a by-the-book art historian at Yale. By the book, studied European Renaissance art. That's what he thought his life would be. And as he began to work in those areas in Washington, Victoria and Albert in London, and then his first really long-term post was at the Nelson Atkins in Kansas City, where he was for 24 years. He started out as an assistant curator for European art and ended up as director when he departed the museum in 1985. And in those years, he helped recreate the museum, not just in these types of arts, but in the modern art side as well. And during the 60s, when so much was going on with art, he collected a few people for the museum, like some guy named Warhol, and as he described it later on, all the blue hairs walked out of the room when he brought that artist in. And I think it was a transformational experience for him to see all these new artists, to have the experiences, with the artists and so forth, and I think it helped change them. The vignette in the front here is, I was just trying to give you a flavor for his house. This is Ted's house. Anybody know where Ted lived?
Yes.
We have too many people here who know Ted. But Ted lived on Agua Fria. He had about 2,500 pieces in his house. He left 200 objects to the Metropolitan Museum of Art as the foundation for their native arts collection.
And became a benefactor for the museum.
And was benefactor for the museum. And the idea is that Ted really felt that the Met does so many things so well, but they hadn't done native arts yet. So by giving those collections there, it's really the formation of the department as a benefactor for the museum. And they are moving that way at this point. But he collected all over the world. As you can see by this photograph, and you can see his house. It was the house in Agua Fria with the totem pole sticking up out of the back. And as we go around the corner here, and be sure to take a look at Ted, and be sure to take a look at what he's wearing. He's wearing his favorite outfit here, and that is a buckle and matching medallion. Come on over here, come on. You especially, Scott, you need to come and start talking. But he's wearing his medallion and belt buckle there, that made by Joyce Growing Thunder Fogarty, a very, very close friend of his. And take a look at that watch that Joyce also made for him.
Yeah. If you want, I was going to say the one thing I would note about the watch is obviously the title and the incredible.
That was a prize book. That's one of my questions.
This is what happens.
When you go ahead, Scott. Question.
Well, no, I obviously you'll read about in the catalog that this was a gift from the Growing Thunder Bogarty family, and that it, you know, is an illustration of the idea of humor within Native art. And I think that too often, particularly with some of the historic material, that we look upon these objects with a sense of reverence, and they tend to assume sort of this sort of somber aura, if you will. You can't help but look at a piece like this, and not only through things like the form and of course the palette and the color, but the fact that it's missing a face, it almost kind of takes on this sort of surrealistic quality, if you will. And it, not knowing Ted personally, and I would want to talk about that in a little bit, but he apparently chronically would check his watch. And the fact that there's no arms, there's no numbers, maybe suggests something about the idea of time in and of itself and what an arbitrary measure it is. And now those of us that tend to be way too preoccupied by it in the 21st century might want to take the time to check the watch and realize that it's not necessarily what we think it is, right? So.
Come on.
Did I take too much?
I'll give you a catalog.
Okay.
As you notice that.
I got
one. So come on over in here. The exhibition is organized around Ted Coe's three seminal Native art exhibitions. Sacred Circles, which opened in 1976 in London, and then opened for its American tour in Kansas City in 1977. Lost and Found Traditions, which opened in 1986 in New York City and traveled to 9 venues. And then Responsive Eye, which opened in the Met, at the Met in 2003. This is the Sacred Circles portion. And the thing about this part is that Ted looked at these objects and he realized that by looking at the objects, there was much more to it. They were not just ethnography, they were not just artifacts, but there were artworks in them. And he wanted people to see that artwork. So in the Sacred Circles exhibition, he selected 672 objects for the London show and 720 objects for the Kansas City show to show you the artistry in the work. So we've tried to do the same here. There's only a few objects here that were actually in the exhibition, both in its London and the Kansas City venues, was largely borrowed works. I mean, over 101 loans in London and nearly 90 loans for Kansas City.
Of course,
City.
That was without cell phones and...
No phone, you know,
all letter writing.
All letter writing, yeah. Once in a while telephone calls.
I would add really quickly that because of that organizational structure, a number of you obviously knew Ted. I didn't. I met him once at a White Hawk show. It was but in passing. But I kind of knew him through the catalogs. Because as a child growing up in the 1970s, my parents had a copy of Sacred Circles.
And I won't say that this was one of my earliest introductions to Native art, but, you know, it was one of those things that was always out on the coffee table, and then invariably you ended up thumbing through it year after year after year. And so I kind of came to know Ted almost as a mythological figure. And I hear all these stories that completely debunk
that,
it really wasn't until graduate school that I started to put kind of two and two together and realize, here's this great curator with these books that I had known all along and could actually remember certain objects that had been on display. And yet to then try and be able to piece that back years later when I met him, I honestly was a little bit in awe, and I'm sure left nothing even closely resembling a memorable impression. But it's again one of those things where we have a collector who had such a profound impact in his field that he really kind of does take on that sort of mythological status, to where he's not just Ted the guy who loved pie or the person who loved collecting, but he's taken on sort of, you know, this almost not supernatural kind of quality, but in the world of Native art, you know, invariably his name is going to pop up in almost any conversation that
you're
in.
Scott, so you say this impact that he left, can you talk a little bit about that impact from both a personal and from just an overall point of view?
I would approach that in two basic areas. The first is as a collector, and then the second would be, you know, as an academic. You write, Rachel, beautifully in the catalog about, and Bruce as well, Ted's sense of seeing, and how in looking at an object, it was this experiential type of moment, that it wasn't simply the registration of, you know, colors and form, etc., and what impact that leaves in our brain, but there was this emotional component to it as well. And I will say that in my own curatorial practice, in my own collecting practice, that is always going to be the crux of it. And at its very foundation is, what type of experience do I have with an object? Mm-hmm. And that then lends itself really beautifully to sort of the academic reputation which Ted had, both as a scholar and you know, he wasn't necessarily the most prominent writer, but what he wrote, you know, was early and prescient, and it helped create the academic study of Native American art, which had sorely been lacking at many institutions and in universities. You know, several of the didactics point to how back in the 1960s and the 1970s, if you wanted to study Native art, it was always grouped as primitive art, and it required an understanding of several other different art forms as well. Mm-hmm. There wasn't any place that you could just study Native art specifically. Mm-hmm. And so today, as former faculty at the University of Oklahoma, mm-hmm. one of my, you know, crowning or things that I like to brag about, mm-hmm. if you will, is that OU now has a PhD program in the study of Native American art.
And do you think that Ted helped push that through?
Invariably. In mm-hmm. fact, knowing Dr. Mary Jo Watson at OU and Dr. Mm-hmm. Jack Rushing at OU, they both knew Ted and obviously had incredible respect mm-hmm. for him. And so I think certainly his footprint, if you will, is not just on that program, but will be on any program either that is currently in existence or that will hopefully continue to develop in the years to come.
If I could add to that a bit. So one of the things was that this idea that it's art, not ethnography,
exactly.
had been decade by decade throughout the 20th century. Somebody had pushed out the idea, you know, in the teens, in the 20s, 30s, 40s, and so forth. There was an exhibit that opened in 1941 at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. But none of those exhibitions had the hold of Sacred Circles. In fact, Sacred Circles was one of four exhibitions in the 1970s that said, it's art. Can you see it as art? Can you see the beauty and not be distracted by the ethnography or the artifacts or something historic? Can you just see the piece? Can anyone name any of the other three? Rachel, it doesn't do any good. Well, there were very prominent exhibitions. There's one in New York, there's one in Minneapolis, and there's one in Chicago, all done by really prominent people. But none of them had the impact of Ted. And it is hard to believe that this is the mid 70s when this happens. So what Ted wanted you to see is like these snowshoes. It's one of my favorite examples in the exhibition. These are most functional thing you can imagine. If you've gone snowshoeing, you know it's a lot of work. You're not really, you're watching your feet because you don't want to trip over yourself, perhaps. You're watching out for sticks and so forth. But you're really pushing into the snow these beautiful objects. Look how beautifully the wood is formed. Look at the shape of them, right? Look and look at the weaving of the sinew on those pieces. That's what Ted wanted you to see. He wanted you to see how beautiful the form and how much time she took. Now, we can also look at the handle of that as that's in there and see how beautiful that bear is carved. Now, the first thing the carver would do would be that he would put his hand over the beautiful part. And all you would see is the manufactured as portion. So what's the purpose of having something so beautifully carved when all you're going to do is cover it up when you're carving? Now, some people would say, and we don't want these people in the room with us, that you don't really need to have the carving. But we know, as appreciators of native art, that the as couldn't do its work without it being beautiful. That's part of its function is to be beautiful. And without the beauty of it, it doesn't function as well.
That actually, Bruce, begins one of the questions that I was going to ask of you, is if you might talk a little bit about, you know, it's termed a curatorial conversation, which is a nice ambiguous term. What does it really mean? So it sort of begs the question of, you know, what is curating? And if you might talk a little bit about not only some of your experience in terms of curating, but both the good and the bad, but you mentioned that idea of selection and how Ted selected pieces. And obviously, in creating this exhibit, we went through and selected another group of pieces. If you might, unpack that a little bit for us. What does it mean to be a curator, basically?
It's a great, great, great privilege, first of all, to be a curator and to work with art and art collections and all that. And so what we did with Ted's collection was this, that very early on, it was left to me to organize the exhibition in some way. And so very early on in the process and my thinking about it, it came to me just to organize it around the three exhibitions. I thought it was the clearest way, without getting too far ahead of ourselves. This is one end of the spectrum to see the objects, to see these beautiful things just as an object. And something that happened to Ted during the run of Sacred Circles in Kansas City, there were 9 straight weeks of programming at the museum. Every day there were Native people in the museum. I'm sure at some point he had met people along the way, but in fact he made his first trip to the Northwest Coast in 1968, but I'm not sure he saw beyond the history of people, saw them beyond 1890. I think that, I just don't know that, just as a fact, you know. But at 1977, in April and May, in Kansas City, he met people, and I think it changed his mind. And that then became lost and found traditions. So you had history, just object, plane, no people, and the other end became all about people. Mm. So the intellect with the heart, right? Intellect with the emotion. He really began to understand, and so he spent the rest of his life from that point on, traveling throughout North America and meeting people and talking to people, making the relationships with people, understanding that object, even when we don't know the person who made these historic things, there's still a relationship that we look at and try and find.
Right.
And then the last piece, the last exhibition was cleared then as responsive eye, and that's in between. Your eye balances between the emotion and the intellect, and that's why the organization of the exhibition is like it is. So I selected there's 180 pieces in the exhibition. I selected 500 possible candidates, and we laid them all out. And the best part of the process then was bringing a series of people into the foundation, Native and non-Native, people who knew a lot about the collections, and just talking about the selections and weeding it down, as hard as it was at times to not have a particular piece in for different reasons. It improved the exhibition exponentially, because that collaborative process is the most. So for me as a curator, it's really about a conversation.
Right.
And I think in some ways, if you want to know the last thing I'd say about being a curator, we've always curated backwards. And what I mean by that is we've always curated to the opening of the exhibition, and then the money's out, and we're on to the next project. Really, we should be curating to about 30% to the opening of the exhibition, and then that begins the conversation, because the most interesting people is people like yourselves who come into an exhibition do I make any sense, or do the people who curated the exhibition make any sense at all? But that's not the way institutions quite work right now. But we're hoping to change that.
But that's one of the nice things about this exhibit, and I want to return to that point later, because I had asked about a question insofar as the audience and what sort of experiences do they bring, and how does that influence and impact an exhibit. But you said something about a curator as a conversationalist. And I really like that idea, because it's hinged upon the idea of dialogue, not just between, you know, who do we talk to? We talk to people, right? But particularly with someone like Bruce, or someone especially like Ted, we also kind of talk with objects. And so there's this incredible balance that I think curatorial practice requires between being a people person and being able to not only interact with collectors, but also artists, and sort of, you know, the intermediary role that you play there, but specifically as it relates to the objects themselves, and what sort of dialogue do we end up having with them, both as curator and as well as audience members, because, you know, I walk around this room and it's deafening, the stories that are being told, right? We just have to learn how to sort of listen to them. And so I think that's one of the things that I would ask of Bruce and Rachel, and particularly those of you that knew Ted, is along the way as we talk about a piece, if there's any sort of story that jumps to mind, that as much informs the curatorial process and practice as any sort of didactic or identification or statement about materials or an attribution of date ever can.
Good point. All right. So I don't know if people are looking carefully. Come over here and look carefully at these two objects. I just think that sometimes we don't see things as carefully as we might because we don't look as carefully as we can. So everybody, the blue bag, just take a quick look at that bag as you go by it or stand by it. This is the lost and found traditions part of the exhibition, and in this part of the exhibition, again, Ted is traveling around, he's meeting people, and he's talking to people, so he buys this blue bag here from Maynard Whiteout, okay, and he buys that bag, and it's really beautiful from afar, isn't it? It really is. It really is spectacular, and you really wonder what Ted saw about the piece when he purchased it, and why he thought he needed to have it. He certainly didn't need another beaded bag in his collection. Let's just be clear about that. And I think Ted probably would have been the first to say that. But when he saw the bag, it was irresistible to him.
It spoke to him. He always talked about how it spoke to him, or it's as good as it gets. And then on to the next room. Oh, this one is as good as it gets. And it's like, oh, but Ted, they're all as good as it gets. How can you explain that to me? So, he didn't have an answer.
So one of the, I don't think any of us have an answer for collecting in time. So, but the thing about this bag, which is truly astounding, is the beadwork is absolutely flat. It's all in the same plane. Right? Does everybody see that? Mm-hmm. But what he did in doing the beadwork is he changed direction of the beads in the way that when he put them down in his stitching, right? So there's all sorts of directions going on. So that black line on those floor on the leaf pattern on the towards the bottom there, those look like they're just raised up like a foot from the surface of the bag. But it's just because of the way he beaded those as compared to the beads inside that give that illusion. So if you consider that this is how good people can be with the materials, whether it's a basket or a textile, it doesn't really mean that. But this is what Ted began to see about objects, is that in the same way, one of my favorite pieces in the exhibition is this beaded sash here. Oops, I'm sorry. Kick your cane. And this beaded sash. So one of the great things about beadwork is this beaded sash from Mono Lake. Does anybody know what fascinates at least me about that sash?
Which one?
I'm going to look at this one over here. What do you think about that sash? What a melange of colors. I mean, just think, it's like palette. It's like she just had a bucket of beads and just used every color possible on these beads. But look how wonderfully it's put together. I think that's one of the trademarks of beadwork that way, that it really gets put together in a very particular way. And these colors that we normally wouldn't see together really become
like
wonderful together.
It's like, more like a tapestry.
More like a tapestry.
And it's not symmetrical at the bottom.
Yes, just slightly different. That's right. That's the other thing about it, that it's not symmetrical.
And I think that's kind of, from my understanding of the collection, one of the the things that I think Ted probably had as much an appreciation for was the technique that was involved. And, you know, Rachel writes in the book about how, you know, the best of the best, right? Mm-hmm. But the best of the best, you know, as an appraiser, we tend to equate that in terms of dollar signs, right?
Yes,
and so
yes.
The better it is, the more expensive
it
is.
But it was about monetary.
Exactly. Things. And, you know, in working with any of the collectors that I do, the most important thing is that it speaks to you, that you have that sort of connection with it, and that, you know, collecting art for investment purposes is very different than collecting art because you have to collect art, right? And so for Ted, you know, looking at something like this, it didn't matter if this were a $50 sash or a $50 million sash. What intrigued him, I suspect, had to deal with the colors, had to deal with the technique, the construction, and especially in something like this, the design of it as well.
But he also looked at the potential of a new artist upcoming, like you had Ken Williams here. I remember him writing to me about Ken Williams. I got this package around Christmas time, wasn't expecting it, had a bad day, opened it up, and was amazed to find this little beaded pouch and this letter explaining Ken Williams, he's this really interesting young artist I just met. I thought you would enjoy this. He's doing some really good work. I'm going to watch him, sort of thing. And the fun thing was once I moved to Santa Fe and I go down to the trading post, Ken Williams has taken over, and I say, "Hi, Ken, I'm Ted Coe's niece. It's a pleasure to meet you. And I have one of your bags. Ted sent it to me." And he told me the whole story, which Ted didn't even tell me. Basically, Ted had commissioned that bag specifically for me from Ken, and I had never known that. So it was an amazing moment for me.
One of the things that people are talking about, thinking about Ken for a moment, I think Ken is one of the most traditional people living in Santa Fe, Native people living in Santa Fe. And, you know, he does drive a Mercedes, he loves to travel, loves good food, and he makes fantastic beadwork, like with this pictorial form on it. It's not what you would see 100 years ago, perhaps. But he's the most traditional person. And I think that's an important topic because people get caught up about, in Native art in particular, about what's traditional and what's not. What's traditional, what's contemporary, what's modern, what's traditional. So everybody's always hung up. And tradition seems to be sometime late in the 19th century, it sort of ended, right? And everything since then has somehow changed. Ted was very interested in the change. But what Ted saw about the change is that the change happened long before any Europeans were here on the continent. That change was always happening, and that's why people's cultures and lives were so vital. So a person like Ken, while we can point to these exterior things, are meaningless. It's about his insides, it's about his emotions and his heart and the way that he shares and the way he participates within his own community, his family, within the Native community here in Santa Fe. So I'm gonna switch up, and I've got one of my questions.
Sure.
Okay. So you're dealing with private, and I've dealt a lot with public collections in my career, so I'm just wondering what the difference between a private and a public collection is.
Great question, and I had a similar one for you as well, particularly given how, you know, the Coe collection has experienced that kind of transition from a private collection to an institutional one. And this relates to another question that I was going to ask of Bruce insofar as, you know, the William Penhallow Henderson designed Wheelwright Building is one of my favorite buildings in all of Santa Fe, always has been. But let's face it, it presents some curatorial challenges. And, you know, we all kind of gasp when we say that. One of the things that I thought was so interesting is the way that the exhibit sort of works with the environment in a way that's very different than, say, when you're dealing with a private collection. Because in his house, Ted probably did think, I need something to go over the couch, right? This is a decorating sort of question that
we all experience.
The Monet was over the couch, so he didn't
really care. Yeah, but not necessarily, because he sort of let the piece find its place.
In the home. And again, in the four-minute process.
So he would bring it home, and then he would put it on a table, and because I do this too. You put it on a table, and you look at it, you have a moment, you get to know each other, it's a relationship, and then eventually, sooner or later, it tells you where it wants to go.
Yeah, sort of how a fetish picks us. I remember Kent McManus talking about that in a previous Wheelwright
collection. But then he would move things around.
Exactly.
How about other people? Do people buy things for a place in the home?
Do you buy things for a place in the home?
I can't imagine you doing that. So you look at a wall and then you want something for it?
No, I want a comfortable chair and I go, oh, you know, just the place I can put that mask.
Okay. But how about artwork and stuff?
Oh, artwork constantly turning over.
Okay.
I think that maybe collectors, and this kind of speaks to some of the similarities as well as some of the differences between curation and collecting, right? Is that collectors they live with their collection. You know, it'd be great and wonderful if we could take all of this home with us and put it in our house, but obviously that's not going to happen. And so when working at an institutional level, you're buying things for the collection without maybe necessarily thinking, where is this going to go and how is this going to fit in with the other objects on display? I don't want to make that sound like you never consider that, but I think for the private collector, It becomes a little bit more of a paramount consideration.
Well, I would only try and persuade you that the better curators feel the same way, even though it may end up on a shelf in a
storage.
But we don't call it storage; it's
collections.
So I had an experience with the paintings collections at the Museum of Indian Arts, where I was chief curator, and I still gasp when I see those collections. And they're still some of the most beautiful things I've ever seen. It doesn't change my relationship that I can't have them at home. There'd be too many for the house anyways. Plus, I couldn't open any windows or anything because they're watercolors. Uh-huh. But the point being, I think we still have that relationship, curators and private collectors. It's a bit different. I understand that part of it. We don't throw our keys into the pots that are the museum's collections.
So for like a private collector, they're going to collect from this passion. Mm-hmm. And so in the beginning, Ted just had this passion. He would see an object, it would spark his interest, and then in some cases he would just go and collect in that area for a while because it helped him understand what that was about. Mm-hmm. But for a museum, and also towards the end of my uncle's life, he started thinking bigger. Where is my legacy going to go? And then he started to collect differently. He collected to fill holes in the collection. Mm. And that's what institutions do, because they want, in most cases, they want to be more encyclopedic than just, you know, a little of this and a little of that. So that's sort of the direction he changed towards the end.
So Joan, can I call on you to talk about passion and collectors a little bit? Joan has worked with collectors for quite a while, let's just say, and then continues to do so, but worked for a long time with Dewey Galleries here in town, and then continues to work with collectors. I'm just wondering about passion, if there's something about collectors or people that you could say out loud.
Well, maybe referring back to Ted, you know, I met him in the early to mid 80s when he was coming out here on a regular basis. He did come to Dewey Galleries, where I was director at the time, and we struck up an immediate friendship, and I actually went to his home for the first time through a mutual friend we had, which was Rick Dillingham, who was fabulous pottery expert and author himself, and ceramist himself as well. And so, actually, visiting Ted for the first time with Rick was kind of speaking to that, because it was for a glass of wine, and, you know, he just went on and on about passion, and I think it is that, to your last point, collecting without knowing where you're going to put the object. You just know somehow your heart is really dictating to you, you must have this piece.
You aren't thinking about where it's going to go.
No, you'll make it work. no matter what, you will, or it will find its own spot, actually, you know, sometimes. And but just as a passionate person who collects, Ted, and I think really the person that I have worked for a long time, and most of us who do collect, you know, we just, there is a drive that we have that really nothing can stop.
It's a life sentence.
It's part of our breathing and walking.
We collect as we have to.
My family's first disease. So we have a gene that you can turn on and turn off. The problem is the gene usually is on.
So I don't see where you turn it off.
You can't turn it off. It's like I go to Indian market or I go somewhere. It's like I'm turning it off.
Bruce, I'm curious because this is an interesting point for me because I would think that, you know, a collector is always buying something because they have to have it. When you're working with an institutional collection, was there ever an acquisition that you had that you thought, this is important for the institution, it's important for the collection, and there's no way I'd ever have something like this in my own home?
Oh, absolutely. You're always thinking beyond yourself. You're thinking future generations. So I think being a curator has some different aspects to it, but as far as the passion for the collections, and I think the other thing, a curator needs to be careful that he or she doesn't get too narrow, because you can get so narrow that you don't see things on a shelf. There was a pot I passed every day at MIAC shelf, in MIAC, I passed it every day on that shelf, and I never thought much about it. I didn't care for it personally. But then I took a moment to look at it, and I realized what it was, and it's one of my favorite pieces. And it's just a little square bowl, and it happens to be made in 1909 from a lump of clay from an ancestral village, and a rock art panel from another, and the potter was someone named Maria Martinez in 1909. Other than that, you know, I don't know if it has too much importance, but I just passed by it every day and didn't think much about it. So we have to be open always to seeing things that we don't know about.
One of the great things, particularly about the great curators, is that they change their minds. That it's not because I wrote this 20 years ago and I had this in this exhibit that's got to be the end of the conversation. That the great curators, like Bruce had suggested, you know, it's a constant ongoing conversation. And one that hopefully really, you know, experiences a multitude of voices as opposed to mine's the only voice.
The other thing that happens, because in the museum world in particular, because the collections are often have been removed from the communities and the families who made them, is that the most astounding, most appreciative moment you often have is you have a family member come in and find something that that was theirs. Yeah. And that happens. That happens again and again with collections as we change the way that institutions work. And that's the most important change in terms of appreciating something that even the most crumpled thing in a drawer, you just never know what it's going to be. Like a meal ticket that has a little quill string attached to it that somebody loved, that this is a ration ticket for a Northern Plains community. And they punched every time they got their ration of flour and stuff like that. But somebody took the time to quill that. And then you meet the person whose grandfather that was, that probably quilled that, or whose ration ticket it was. It's like, that's an unforgettable little piece of cardboard, you know, that's sitting there. And then it reaches far beyond the drawer that it's in.
Yeah.
That's unimportant. That's just totally unimportant. Anybody else about passion collecting?
Yes.
Gerald.
My wife and I are collectors. She comes from a curatorial world. I come from the art dealing world. And we often went shopping together. And then afterwards, if we weren't doing that, we'd say, okay, what would we buy for the museum? What would we buy for home? And they were only the same thing once.
Really?
Because we were in a very narrow gallery, and I was ahead of Penelope. And I said, I want to buy that. And she said, I want to buy that. And the Metropolitan Museum had priority over us as collectors. Yeah. But then the artist said, I'll make you even a better one for the Metropolitan Museum. So it worked out. But what I meant to say, it's a different way of looking at things.
It is. In fact, I know a lot of, you know, I think Henrietta alluded to this when she gave a similar conversation here. There are institutions which will prohibit a curator from collecting in the area that they're in. Penelope, you're shaking your head.
It's crazy. I mean,
because you're supposed to be this in-depth scholar, but emotionally divorce yourself from all of that work that you've done so that, you know, you'll have curators of paintings who collect ceramics or ceramic curators who end up collecting something completely different. And, you know, I am blessed, quite frankly, that I'm not limited in those, and I'd never had to sign an agreement with someone saying, yes, you appraise Native art, yes, you curate Native art, but no, you can't possibly collect it. Well, because that would be like tying a hand behind your back.
The abuse of a few make the
rules. Well, and this is true.
So I mean, let's just put it that way.
It's happened.
And just, why don't we move on to the next over here, unless there's another comment about passion collecting. Questions about the objects we're standing around. We didn't talk as much as we do sometimes about the objects. But let's move over here in front of the moccasin case.
I want to ask you about, because what I love about your curatorial vision and direction and that some of the exhibits that you've put together is that, you know, and this is a beautiful illustration of it, too often exhibits of Native art are tied to the two, you know, stakes in the ground of chronology, and that we have to show everything chronological, and this is the old stuff, and this is the new stuff, and never the twain shall meet. And even more troubling is that stake of geography. And how many exhibitions have we been to where this is the Northeast, this is the Southwest, this is Northwest Coast material? And so a display like this, you know, we're spanning centuries, and we're spanning continents. And so if you would, Bruce, talk a little bit about, you know, how you're trying to sort of buck against that trend and other younger curators are sort of following your lead in that regard.
Well, I don't know if anyone follows my lead, but thanks. I think the main point of doing things like this, I think that chronology and geography are important points to learning about things and understanding them, because there's a reality that art changes through time. That no matter what art form it is, whether it's moccasins or pottery or baskets, they change through time. So you see that chronology if you line them up, and then things are different. There's a reason why people wore different moccasins. People identified themselves by what they wore, just the same way that we identify ourselves by what we wear every single day. So I think by jumbling it up, it gets people to pay more attention. That's part of one of my things, you know, that I just think it just forces people to look more carefully. I think it could be rather lazy of the curator to just put everything out just by the chronology. I mean, it's great. The culture area thing works in some way. That's what Scott was describing. And there's utility to it, but I think we need to just think so much harder to really get people to begin to see the work as it is, not as we imagine it to be. And geography and chronology can be those things that are just our imaginations about the material. So there's one of the things I said about the foundation, and one of the things we're trying to do in this case, is give you the reason why Ted collected so many things, which is comparative. So some people collect the one best object, as they say in the business, a 10. Did that exist before that film, that term? I just can't stand it. Space the scale of that film. So some people just collect the best of the best, they say, and I'm not buying anything else. And they keep trading that piece out till they have the one singular example of that. Ted never wanted to do that, and that was why he couldn't do sacred circles with less than 700 objects. Usually an exhibition, even a grand exhibition, will have about 130 to about 200 pieces in it. So one of the things that Ted wanted people to see is the greater scope, the greater variety of things. And so that's one of the things he did. He wanted people to see all these different varieties of footwear from around the country, around the hemisphere, around North America. The other thing about Ted and the origin of the good pie part of the title are like these three pair up here. He passed by this woman's house about every third or fourth year as he was driving up to Alaska. And it was on the way to a good pie place. So he had to stop in and get the mukluks from her, or just the moccasins rather, and then also art from other people that were making them, because not all these are the same. These two are the same woman, this is someone different over here. But the point being that he wanted to stop in, wanted to say hello to her, and the $50, $100 was better in her pocket than his pocket, he always thought, and then he could have pie as well. So part of it is the dedication to people and building those relationships and maintaining those relationships. And part of it is just that he couldn't say no and he wanted people to see a fuller variety. So that's what this case is truly about. It also brings up other issues, I think, which are very important. We think of objects as being stuck in time when we collect them. That they're, so this pair of Crow moccasins and leggings are 1930. You just have to take my word on it. It's a style made of Crow up in Montana, 1930s. Now, that's fine to say that. I'm pretty close on the 30s. Mm-hmm. Anybody want to dispute the 30s? Okay, I'm in luck. But the point being about these, that these were heavily remade by Joyce Growing Thunder Fogarty in the 1990s. So, or late 80s, rather. So maybe they're really Joyce's 1980s and not the Crow Woman, Yellowtail is her last name, 1930s. So what do we do with that sort of thing when things are remade constantly and rethought about? Because the other mistake that I just laid out on you too is that I've given you individual names. Joyce is part of a family, part of a community. So these artists often work in that broader community on these types of arts. And I think that's important that we tend to look, can you make this into such and such, a Perry Bethel piece? You know, is this her work? Well, maybe, maybe not. But that, so this case brings up all those issues.
Well, it underscores two other things that I think, again, Bruce is one of the scholars leading this charge, as it were, is too often things would be identified only by their nationality. And that this was Anishinaabe, and this was Santa Clara. And over the past 20 years, it's been sort of a trend in curatorial practice to try and provide individual attribution to objects. And as a result, we're learning so much more, not just about the object itself, but we're starting to be able to develop artist biographies that 20 years ago, curators just simply weren't as concerned with. And now that, you know, sort of focus on the individual artistry, as it were, I think is one of the new waves, if you will, in terms of curating Native art. Another thing that I absolutely love about this particular display, and we can say this about any number of them, but I think that, you know, we're talking about a classically trained art historian. And so Ted was very familiar with something like color theory, and not only how this was applicable to, say, old master paintings, but obviously Native artwork as well. And so when I see a display like this, obviously color is one of the first things that jumps out, and the palette. And so I imagine Ted, you know, as a collector, having that as one of maybe the guiding focuses, and that it wasn't necessarily about an object per se, but maybe a theme as it related to palette and to color. And I think we'll see other examples in some of these cases where it's maybe not so much a concern with, say, palette, but rather with form.
Any other questions, comments on the case?
Yes,
yeah. I was curious to know if he, some collectors, and we tend to do this sometimes, they meet an artist as a young person, they follow their work for 30 years mm-hmm. and want a sample of a piece from different periods of their career. Mm-hmm. Did he have a tendency to do this at all?
I was going to say, Rachel, do you want to take that one?
Well, yeah, he did. One example, which I think we'll get into later, is the Growing Thunder family. I just found out recently, because I've kind of come into the Growing Thunder family
right.
now, and I found out when I was with them this summer that he met Joyce Growing Thunder on the street by accident in, I think it was Wyoming mm-hmm. Or Montana.
Jackson Hole,
yeah. And I actually happened to be he was coming to see me and my aunt in Jackson Hole when that happened. So I found that really kind of interesting that I'm putting this all together. And I was just a little, you know, kid just out of high school. Parents took me out there to keep me out of trouble, whatever. Anyway, she told me the story. She was standing in her traditional dress waiting for, I think, her husband or somebody. on the side of the road there, and Ted and his friend come up, and Ted just starts talking with her because he found her interesting. Mm-hmm. And she thought this was weird and didn't say a whole lot. But later that day, they went to a trader, and I'm not sure if he was there first or she was there first, but basically they were formally introduced, and that started a lifelong relationship where he became her patron in a way, and the patron, and encouraged her daughter and her granddaughter as well. So you have Joyce, and then you have Juanita and her daughter. You have Joyce's son, Dale Growing Thunder, and that whole family. So he became like an uncle and encouraged them and collected them. And there's actually a story which I'll let Bruce tell later about a particular shirt.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So that'll speak to that a bit. But there were others as well. There's the Keyser family as well up in Maine, and a few others. And I'm sure Ken Williams probably would have turned into one of those, because actually towards the end of his life, he was really collecting people rather than the objects themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. So. And again, that speaks to the idea of conversation,
yes.
Right? Uh-huh. And especially, you know, I like the idea of how it's suggestive of the fact that just as curators can influence artists, so too can collectors. And I would imagine that someone like Ted was, you know, I'm willing to help, you know, provide for you in this respect, but in return for that patronage, you know, we're going to be pushing some boundaries, and we're going to be doing things in terms of the medium or the practice that, you know, maybe hadn't been done before. So there's this almost kind of innovative componentry to collecting and how a collector can, you know, influence an artist in that regard.
Which continues, obviously, to today. Oh, I have
exactly.
some friends who do
exactly.
that. Yeah. And it's a wonderful relationship. I mean, I'm sure you know, creating this relationship with an artist and then actually having the impact through commission or what have you on how they proceed with their lives is it's very rewarding and an honor to be part of that.
Yeah. I think Ted did work with certain people, but I do think it was unsystematic as well.
Oh, he wasn't,
In defense of Ted. He was unsystematic.
Yes.
He saw something, he liked it, he bought it.
Yes.
Like that bag I pointed out from Maynard White Owl.
Yeah.
There weren't rigid rules.
He actually saw it and then walked back to it. He didn't know Maynard at that point, but he developed a relationship. He didn't buy again from Maynard.
Well, he taught me that if you see the piece and if it speaks to you, get it, because it's not going to be there tomorrow. And I've learned that lesson several times since. And you know, it's one we all have to keep learning. But he said, you know, if you got the money, just put something down on it. You know, and he would sit, he had various chairs at various art dealers here in Santa Fe that he would just go sit and have a conversation, give him a few bucks, and then go away, come back, another few bucks, look at the piece that he's going to get, and it could take him a year or more to pay it off.
That kind of raises an ancillary sort of concern. Is anyone willing to share a story about one of the ones that got away?
Well, I have one.
I always go for it.
And this one really pains me to this day. I don't know if any of you have been to the Met, but there's the mosquito mask there that he left to the Met. Well, I was this little college, or out of college, I don't know, early 20s, mid-20s. I'd never collected. Ted taught me you can do this. Bought my first piece for Morningstar. It was actually an archaic horse, $500, and I remember hemming and hawing over that. But anyway, he took me to see Eleanor Tolman Hancock in New York City, and he would scout out people for me when I came to visit. In this case, he had come to the city. He was staying with me. We did stuff. We went over there, and she pulls out this mosquito mask, this Tlingit mosquito mask that is just amazing. I mean, I knew that as a naive person it was amazing. It was $3,000 or so, and they were saying, well, you know, you could do it on time. And this is Ted being selfless, because he knew exactly what it was, he knew exactly how important it was, and he knew exactly how much it really was worth. And he gave me the opportunity to actually purchase that. And I hemmed and hawed and sort of said, well, and time went by, and he snapped it up, and now it's at the Met. Now, I could kick myself really hard.
And it's, you know, that's a testament to the passion, right?
Yeah.
I mean, for all of our achievements and our trophies that we may get, it's amazing how I can remember things that got away every bit as vividly as I can the coups that I got
because my family comes from a museum background, And I feel that when I go to the Met, when I see that mosquito mask, I still feel it is part of my family's heritage.
Exactly.
And when I go to the medieval department and see things that my father bought and worked on that I know intimately, I feel it's part of my family. When I come to the Ralph T. Coe Foundation, I feel the same. The only advantage there is that I actually am living with these things because I live at the foundation. So, you know, it's a wonderful thing to be able to experience that. You know, go to the Met. Okay, go visit my friends. Barbara, let me show you my favorite friend over here. And so I bring them over, and they're like, oh, and we really look at it differently. And I have friends in all the departments.
Well, and it speaks to a critical concern, I think, in terms of museums today. And Bruce, chime in as you see fit. You know, when Ted was at the Nelson, he had something called an acquisitions budget. Now, it may not have been that large, but it at least existed. And I'm afraid that they've gone the way of the dodo bird. And that most museums today, unless they're the Met or MoMA, where they may have millions that they can play with, most museums, and obviously Wheelwright probably among them, any sort of collections development that's taking place only comes through the generosity of its donors. And we obviously can look at the Phillips wing and, you know, the Ruth and Sid Schultz room, and of course Marty's acknowledgement as well. And, you know, if it weren't for that kind of generosity, the Wheelwright might not be the beacon that it is today. It is now the Center for the Study of Southwestern Jewelry, and it's going to become a resource and an asset for generations to come. But again, it was only through the generosity of collectors that realize, and you know, if there's one thing that I would encourage us all to consider, is that we never truly own anything. Our collections aren't really ours, that exactly we are custodians, and that we're only going to have this for a brief period of time.
And that was a huge concern to Ted as he got older, because he wanted to do right by the collection, and he also wanted to inspire people in a way that he'd been inspired, and that meant cross the gamut from young people to older people.
Right.
So that, you know, to get into what the foundation mission is about, that's what, you know, we have this huge broad spectrum of people that we want to reach out to, and without the younger people being involved, all of this will go away. So that's really important.
Let's keep moving.
Yeah.
Shall we?
Let's move over here.
Can we talk about the Crooked Knives?
Yeah. Why don't you start? Hi, Devon. Then everybody move up over here. Questions or comments, clarifications, additions? Everybody's with us still? Okay. Everybody want to bend over once?
There are some chairs around that you can pull up if you want to sit down.
When Bruce invited me to first walk through the collection as they were putting together the exhibit, one of the things that immediately jumped out at me were the Crooked Knives. And, you know, Rachel, you mentioned how he went about trying to fill in holes later. I'm suspecting that something like this may have been then collected very early on, because
this was very
there's not a lot of holes to fill right here, right?
Well,
I mean, we've got an incredible
and
collection.
And the Met did, in part of that gift to the Met, a few knives went to them. But yes, he was very, he went through this kind of crooked knife phase, which my parents took part of.
Really?
So we have a few at my parents' home too. And I always found them as a kid incredibly fascinating.
Oh. Especially, you know, if we look at the previous case and we think about a fundamental, like, color, we can look at this, and what strikes me the most is the idea of form and shape. And how, you know, Ted was clearly focused on the way these are not just made and what, you know, technique was involved, but specifically that form. And so, you know, grouping them together like this, I think, really underscores that idea of form. But if I might make a slight observation about appraisals, don't want to put a number on any single one of these, but I think that this does serve as a beautiful illustration of those instances where the whole is maybe greater than the sum of its parts, and how individually on the market each one of these would have X value attached to it. But when grouped together, particularly over the course of time, such as Ted did, and especially when they're attached to a notable name like Ted Coe, the value of this begins to increase. And we're not just looking at these are 14 or however many, you know, number of knives we have present here, But they take on a greater meaning, and corollary to that, they take on a greater value as well.
So the collector, whether it be Ted or somebody else, adds to the narrative of the objects or objects.
Exactly. It's part of that storytelling act. It's part of that conversation. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. John, you want to tell your story about your previous girlfriend in here?
What?
Joe Blondell.
Oops, sorry. I thought you knew Barbara. So John, go ahead and tell your story about this photo and this one.
Oh, well, it's an age story that, there's a photo on that knife of a woman named Joan Blondell. Does that ring a bell to anybody? She was...
Yes, actress.
You've got to be of a certain age to get that. Yeah, she was a movie star, and she was married to a guy named Dick Powell, also an old name, and I went to school with her son, Norm Powell, who was Joan Blondell and Dick Powell's son, and I looked at that and it made me think of Norm Powell, who I hadn't thought of in 60 years.
I think it's the best story in the whole exhibition, actually.
Also, to kind of reinforce your thoughts on the sum of the parts, there was a guy here in town who collected, collected crease handles. You know, a crease is an Indonesian long blade, and they would carve the handle out of horn or bone very, very elaborately, large or small. You look at one of them and you say, that's a nice piece. You look at two and you say, isn't it nice? You probably had 150 of them.
Wow.
And the impact of that, when you saw that 150 of them nicely displayed, was absolutely incredible. Yeah. Just so dramatic. And these two, I mean, for me personally, that's the best showcase in the house.
Oh, thanks.
I mean, I love that. I think that's incredible.
Well, one of my favorite pieces in the show is this figure right here, this woman. Mm-hmm. I don't know if
I'm
people can see that,
that.
But this is an Argelite piece from Haida Gwaii, which used to be called the Queen Charlotte's. It's home to the Haida people. And this is probably carved about 1850 or so. 1862, Haida went from 10,000 people to about 600 people because of smallpox. But the Haida were right around the coast, and they're right there on the same islands. That's why they're no longer the Queen Charlotte's, but the Haida Gwaii. It's their homelands and continues to be that place. And it's a beautiful, beautiful place on the coast of British Columbia. But this carving here has always fascinated me, and it's a little bit about collecting. So Ted bought that, and he was told it was the missionary's wife. And that's a great story. I think it's a really wonderful story, and it's pure imagination. That would be the missionary's wife for lots of reasons. We always think that something that represents change or a break in aboriginality, indigeneity, because she's wearing a dress, wearing clearly clothes from elsewhere, and style clothes from elsewhere, that it's got to be someone from the outside world. But in fact, it's a Haida woman dressed in those clothes because she's a worldly individual. She knows about fashion, although she might live in the West and not in New York City or even Boston. Mm-hmm. She knows about fashion, and she dresses in a way that tells the world that she is well-connected and worldly. Mm-hmm. So here is a Haida woman in the 1850s shouting out to people who she is, not who people imagine her to be. And I just think it's a part of that. Where do we give the sentience in our discussion about Native arts? We need to give it to Native people about the choices they make. So even the little tiny thing someone makes for a tourist market, and like there's 100 of them on the counter, somebody has thought about all those pieces that they've made. And although they might be made quickly and so forth, there is something about the thought process that continues to make them Native. And I think looking at that intellect and understanding that intellect helps us appreciate pieces like that. Now we're in the lost, and we're going to step into the last couple sections. So lost and found then was about Ted finding people. Found was really Ted's reaction. It wasn't really a good name for the exhibition. It was lost in his education, and through his car driving excursions, he found people. So it really is
sure
a title.
I think you meant it more for the general public.
I'm just playing on it.
Oh, okay.
Before I'm playing on it.
Before we move, Bruce, I want to tell him how smart you are.
Oh, yeah.
Because I think one of the things that lends support to Bruce's hypothesis that this is auto-representation, right? That this is a Haida carver carving a Haida person and not necessarily a missionary's wife is, I think that original attribution had to do with the dress, right? Mm-hmm. But if you pay really close attention, and I could be completely off on this, wouldn't be the first time, but it looks to me as though the one thing that really stands out insofar as any identifying feature are the eyes, which are rendered in the same sort of Northwest Coast form line. And I think that it's in that regard that this artist is identifying the subject as a Haida woman, as opposed to, say, an Anglo missionary's wife.
It's also her posture.
The way her posture as well.
In the way that she's holding herself that tells you that. We're now going to go. So Ted then worked with people. He worked with the art, the people. And this section we're going to go into then is about responsive eye, about him working both things into his understanding of the artwork. And I think it's great that we can look at things. We can say that's a Nampeo pot. We can say this is a Tabata Lavo basket. Anybody know what type of basket that is?
Kern River.
I'm not going to give you a catalog for that. It's a Tabata Lavo basket. I think those are really important things that we're able to do, that we're able to look at something. And I can tell you all about this Tabata Lavo basket. I can't tell you who wove the basket, but I can identify it as terms of where she's from, or the Nampeo pot up there. We can identify it as in terms of her making it. We can also discuss whether it's really hers or not. There's a lot of people who spend their entire lives talking about things like that. But the really thing, what I'm really interested in being able to do those types of things, is that we can do them. Not that it's enough to say it's Tabata Lavo. I mean, that's fine, but why? And how are we able to do that? And that's the amazing thing about the artwork, is we're able to go far beyond just identifying something, which is just one way as a doorway into other information. This moose hide coat was one of the prizes of Ted's collection. He collected it late in his life, in the mid-2000s. And one of the things about it, there's about 12 of these in the world. And these have amazing stories. People are doing a little scholarship now. But the way these coats seem to all go is they're all collected in Europe. There's very few of them here in the U.S. And they tend to come out of Scotland and England, who were the trappers for the Hudson Bay Company. Mm-hmm. So these Hudson Bay trappers came a lot from Scotland. They were also English. And they came to Canada, what's now Canada, to the Americas. And they spent maybe 10 or 20 years. And they took up with a native woman as a wife, and they usually had children with those women as well. But when they were ready to go back to Scotland, the wife, the native woman, gave some of these men these coats. This is cut exactly like an 18th century coat. The point being that there was some type of relationship that allowed the woman who made the coat, or had the coat made for her husband, that she was seeing him leaving, but she gave him the coat to remember her, perhaps, or to think about her, or good riddance, here's a coat, don't get cold. Who knows what she's saying, but it's such an interesting thing. This coat in the back is cut just like those 18th century coat, like you see the guy in the little short leggings and the stockings and the buckled shoes. The buckled shoes are kind of what this fashion looks like, these Huron moccasins in the base there. And then it's very simple, it has a little bit of dot pattern on it, and the epaulettes on the shoulders also clearly call out European styles, military styles in particular. What types of people did native people see at these outposts and trapping stations and forts, whether it's in what's now United States or in Canada? They saw a lot of military people, right? So the epaulettes make a lot of sense in that way. The epaulettes, Ted writes about in his catalog, the collection, he writes about it, that they're actually underwater serpents. Not a serpent. Well, anyway, it's one of those animals. Whoops. I just totally lost what that was supposed to be. But an underwater creature that lives, and it's very important for people in that region of Canada. And he thought it's the representation of that creature in the water. So these objects, then you should be thinking about people. At the same time, you're thinking about how beautiful they are.
Can anybody, you know what this is over here without looking at the label? This red piece here? You know what that is? Anybody know what that is? Don't look at the label. Can't look at the label, all right?
It looks like a bow tie, but...
It looks like a bow tie. You're not going to catalog for that. Lucky thing. What do you think?
Hair band.
You're getting close. That's very close.
Something for a horse.
Something for a horse. Getting further. So it's for a woman's hairpiece. It gets tied the back of her hair. The back of the hair, right? Okay. So in the braids or a single braid. Okay, so it's staccato, all right? So it looks, and what does it look like? So think about the back of the head. Just first of all, think about the woman wearing that. It is heavy, just like it looks. So think about her posture as she's dancing with it, right? You can't have a lot of movement, relatively speaking. You've got to keep your head upright to keep the piece looking right and to keep the piece in your hair, right? So there's a certain posture that evokes just by wearing it that's really important to think about. There's also something else about it. Caddo and Pueblo languages are related languages. Mm-hmm. I'll just give you that clue. Hairstyle in the Southwest.
The Hopi.
The Hopi.
No.
Not that thing.
Not that.
The Chongo back, right? Mm-hmm. Looks very much like one of those Chongos, doesn't it? And not the Chongo brothers, but the Chongo piece.
It's funny though, Bruce, you mentioned the fact that it's to be static.
And No. Because of the movement. It evokes a posture. Gotcha. Not static, but evokes a posture. Helps her with proper movement, symmetry in her dance.
The reason I mention that is because immediately next to it, we've got these fantastic Kiowa moccasins, which the fringe is one of the more identifying characteristics on those pieces. And while it looks great and wonderful as it sits there, static, unmoving, imagine what these look like when they're worn for dancing and the movement and the rhythm that they would create.
Well, Terry
as a result.
Greaves, when she was here, she was referring to that as well, but she went further to say that it becomes a form of prayer when everything is moving. Yep. The person, the clothing, all of it together is a form of prayer.
Well, the static comment actually is very valid in the sense that you take these things which were made for totally different purposes. Not one of these pieces in here were made to sit in these cases.
Nope.
Yep. Now, they were made for show, right? To show some that you really appreciate it as a cradle strap that went across the front of a child, to show how much you cared for that child or how much you cared for the dance, right? Those types of things. But they were all made to be seen in movement. So you lose some of that in the cases. You don't get that sense unless there's an earthquake here in Santa Fe, and then we can see everything move at once. But so there is some things about saying things get so static. The coat looks far more static now than it looked on me just a few months ago when I was wearing it. not true. So I think how you get movement back into things is part of the curatorial question we were talking about earlier.
And I think it evokes, you know, kind of a query insofar as what are the future of, or does the future of curatorial practice hold? And, you know, I'm thinking about all the innovations that we're making in terms of technology and how, you know, objects that previously before we would not have been able to display because of improvements in technology we now can. And how something like that, you know, it might be 10 years from now, it might be 50 years from now, but there may be some new technology that comes about as a result where we can actually show those in movement.
Perhaps.
As opposed to, you know, with one step short of, I was going to say, 3D printing, or, you know, we don't want to have a live demonstration and have, you know, somebody come in and put them on, but I'm always, you know, as I walk through a museum exhibit, part of the curatorial conversation that I like to have is, you know, where are we going to be in 2025? Where are we going to be in 2050? Where are we going to be in 2010? Because there are some critical issues facing museums today. We've previously alluded to budget, but one of the issues, if any of you read in the paper, you know, the University of Oklahoma just repatriated a Pissarro painting that had been the issue of acclaim. Repatriation is becoming an incredibly important issue for museums. And, you know,
these are some of the things that maybe weren't as big an issue 50 years ago, kind of big today. Think about where it's going to be in 50 years from now.
But I don't mean to be, I would add something to that.
Please.
I think 50 years ago, there were just as big issues. But the difference today is that there's more voices being heard.
There you go.
So
there
it's, you go. And things, yeah. And because there's more voices today, things are that much better. Mm-hmm. But the demise of museums, I would just go another way. So a few years ago, a couple decades ago, people predicted the demise of paper, right? Mm-hmm. Because everybody would have electronic note. Mm-hmm. So does anybody have less paper? There's more paper than ever. A few years ago at this point, people predicted the demise of books because of Amazon. Quite the opposite. Your private bookstores, small bookstores, are making a comeback, not just here in Santa Fe, but elsewhere. So, I mean, there's several things.
Like the bookmaking program at Mills College, where you actually have people that are studying how to make
the art of the book. Exactly. There are a number of programs like that. My old alma mater has one.
Do they?
Yeah, but I think having worked in a museum, and I'm sure Bruce may feel the same, museums have to, you know, everything changes, right? We're all evolving and moving forward, whether we like it or not. And it's how you deal with that. How do you embrace that? Mm-hmm. And museums need to embrace that and reinvent themselves. And some are being successful. Some are trying things that doesn't work. They're trying something else. Yeah. And so on and so forth. And I know for like my father, and to a certain extent, Ted, who didn't like these changes. And my dad's just like, oh my god. But anyway, you know, and the foundation is part of that.
Exactly.
And we don't have a word to describe what we are, except that we are not a museum, and we are also accessible. And that's what most museums are not, is accessible.
And I don't want to make it sound like that technology is always a good thing, because I was recently at a symposium at the Center of Creative Photography in Tucson at the University of Arizona. And Andy Smith, the photography dealer here in town that some of you may know, was very quick to point out how in the 1960s and 1970s, everybody ran towards microfilm and microfiche. And let's get rid of the original documents. They take up too much space. And we can have it all consolidated in this handy little piece of microfilm. Yeah. Well, we know what's happened to microfilm, right? When's the last time you actually went to the library and used a microfilm reader? That's a while
unfortunately,
ago.
Unfortunately, about a month ago.
But it's a situation where the same thing is happening with the digital revolution. And I can't help but wonder, and not to get all sci-fi and Terminator on you, but, you know, what happens if we get to a point where we don't have the computers that we've relied upon so heavily, and if we've gotten rid of the original records, you know, what's lost in the process as well. So it's not just a situation that museums are facing where everything technological is good. We have to be conscious and be able to almost see into the future, if you will, insofar as, you know, how do we preserve things? I remember I juried a art exhibition, a student art show, a number of years ago, and the winning piece was actually purchased by the museum to be included within the permanent collection. And so from an artist standpoint, this is absolutely wonderful and fantastic, and I'm now in a museum collection, right? Well, the piece we selected was a gas mask that had some digital displays on the inside, and the curators really actually tried to discourage us from giving the award to this particular piece, because they were immediately concerned with, how do we store this? You know, rubber decomposes over time, and what are we going to do in the digital media? What's going to happen to it? And so, you know, getting back to that process of selection, right? How there are so many different factors that an institutional collection will face that for the private collector really isn't that much of a consideration at all.
That's true. Okay.
Can I just say one thing that seems to me central to both private collector and institutional collection, which I think in institutions, not in private collecting, is being downgraded, and that is the object, the thing.
Yeah.
And what Ted's reactions to the thing, when you went to see him, he would focus on one of his things, whatever it was, and the passion, the excitement, yeah, was transmitted to you through the thing.
It was
like this magical process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's the things that are in private collections or in museums, however they're documented, whether they're on microfilm that fries or paper that dissolves, the thing is still there.
Exactly.
And that's why we're all standing here.
Yeah.
Very good.
And you know, there's kind of an appraisal, and Joan can speak to the same issue as well. We've had collectors that we've had to remind that they're collecting art, not autographs, right?
Yes.
And they'll get so consumed of, I've got to have a Terry Greaves in my collection, right? Not that we all shouldn't have a Terry Greaves in our collection, but, you know, it's a, speaking to Penelope's concern, it's about the object, and that, you know, it doesn't matter if it's signed by Picasso or signed unsigned. You know, if it's a great object, then the object should
speak for
itself.
But part of that problem of looking for the, and I hate to say it, so the designer
right.
object
yeah.
is that they're looking at the monetary value. They're not being, they're not looking at the object and letting it speak to them and go with their passion. They're going with the dollar signs.
Yep.
I saw that a lot of, when I was at the Whitney Museum, and I found it very discouraging. You're always going to have that. You know, I was lucky that through my parents and particularly through my uncle, I was able to get bitten by that bug and see it from a different perspective.
And see in parentheses.
Yeah, because then you can get past the monetary and
exactly.
you can move into what is this about, the history and all that.
Just to keep us going here. So this last section of the exhibition is about the growing vendors. And this this was a very close, I think Rachel said, like an uncle. Ted is an uncle in the family. He's a relative in the family, and as people say in the Indian way. And he was a very important member of the family. And he does talk about objects in the catalog. He talks about this little bag here that Juanita made. And he talks about watching her development from a very young person, a five-year-old, to someone who's of great importance in the art world. Ted also, this is there is a place where Ted's legacy, you can really talk about Ted's legacy, it's through the growing thunders. This is a woman of, Joyce, this is Joyce here with the puppies. And Joyce is a woman of great talent. And what Ted did was he helped the non-native world see this great talent as art. He invited her to Indian Market, he took her to exhibitions, got her in exhibitions. So it was a really mutual conversation that they had that really helped turn beadwork into an art form. Well, people would really look at it as an art form and begin to understand its intricacies and its nuances. And Ted's relationship with them is so interesting. This shirt up here, Ted, the Lost and Found Traditions was opening in Los Angeles. Ted went over to Los Angeles. It was at the Museum of Natural History, LA County Museum of Natural History. And he knew Joyce was there, and he went up to the table where Joyce was, and Joyce had a long face on. She was very upset about something. And Ted asked her what was wrong, what was going on. She said, well, I had made this shirt to sell this man, and he had been asking for it for a great long time. And so he came, and he saw the shirt, and he said, well, how much is the shirt? And she said, well, $3,000. And he said, well, I can't pay $3,000. This is 1992. He said, I can't pay $3,000 for the shirt. There's just no way. And this will be the one that got away from this guy. This is about a $35,000 or $45,000 shirt now. And Ted said, well, I'll buy it from you. And Ted was never wealthy. So he bounced a check over to her, and somehow it stuck. And Joyce, being who Joyce is, had probably come with no money, just got to Los Angeles and expected the sale of the shirt to provide money for the family to eat as well as to drive back home. And so Ted took the shirt, and Joyce gave him one further condition, and that condition was that when Daryl needed it to dance, that they could come get the shirt.
Right.
So Daryl danced in the shirt several times.
Her son, Daryl.
I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Her son, Daryl. Thank you. And then another thing about why we put these leggings here is that Joyce showed up with the leggings one day and said, Ted, you have to have these. And says, well, why do I need to have these? He said, well, if you're going to keep talking about Native people and about beadwork, I want you to understand more about how things are done. So it's kind of like the timeless watch. And I want you to understand that it's not like an outfit off the rack. You don't go into the store and buy one outfit, but you accumulate your outfit as you go along. So these leggings, I made them go with the shirt. They don't match it directly, but they go with it.
So think about this as an accumulation about how we do, Joyce say, how we do things to Ted. So it's a learning piece for Ted, and because Joyce very much understood that Ted was a sort of interpreter or doorway into her world. And these other pieces do many things. And one of the, we were talking about movement. One of the great pieces for movement, I think, in here is this little shirt, this little model shirt here. And it looks great on the stand. Don't get me wrong. It's gorgeous, all the rest of that. But I tell you, when the fringe moves, it's that much better. It really is a fantastic piece. What else, Scott? We've got a few more minutes here. So.
First, just a yes, quick John. Observation. Barbara asked earlier if he ever collected throughout an artist's life. Yeah. He must have had immense pride when he saw how the Fogarty kids and grandchildren became so brilliant on their own.
Oh, he did. He used to talk about it to us. He was thrilled, and he'd come and say they're doing such great work. And, he would travel in their car, and they'd all had a great time. And I think it was really a very important thing in his life to have Joyce and her family.
Right. It was also such a revelation for Ted. Again, came from a well-to-do family and went to Yale and was a curator and a director in this big museum. And then he hangs out with the Growing Thunders. They're camping outside. He talks about shaving in the bathroom and gas stations. You're eating greasy burgers all the time.
Sleeping on the dirt.
So it changes his outlook of the world in such a positive way. You don't need all the trappings to be happy. There are many other things. And he traveled to powwows with them and had the treatment at powwows of being a Growing Thunder, which was another aspect that expanded his horizon. So these are pieces and cases, right? And they look like they're tangible. But really, I think for Ted, this part of the collection, more than any other part, is the intangible part. I think he saw right through these pieces to the family in which he was a member. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think that's such an important thing to think about in terms of these pieces and all the collection. But these are the easiest to talk about in terms of Ted's understanding of things far beyond. I would say this one other point. We had talked briefly before about him writing. I think when he was writing about European things early on in his career, he started as an undergraduate writing book reviews for things. And he wrote pretty easily as long as he was writing about European things. But as he started to try and write about native art and native peoples, I think the writing became more difficult for him. And he wrote less and less as he went on. I think the same way that he looked and saw the Growing Thunders with these pieces, that intangible, he understood just how much more complicated it was than sitting down and hammering out an article or two. I think it was a revelation for him, it was an epiphany for him. It was certainly a life change that giving up the good life in Nelson Atkins.
Exhibit like this kind of gives us an idea insofar as what we can expect, say, in the next 100 years. Not just in terms of the exhibit itself, but, what sort of new innovations are Native artists, working towards and in new mediums. One of the things that, not to toot Bruce's horn, promise it'll be the last time, but one of the classes...
Pay you enough?
Yeah, no, near. That check bounced, by the way. One of the things that I taught at the University of Oklahoma was Native American film history. And it was a course that had never previously been on the books that's now offered every other semester. Native film is one of those new and thriving areas in terms of Native art. And it was something that for years had been completely overlooked and dismissed by SWIA until Classification X. And now all of a sudden it's one of the more popular areas in terms of Indian market every single year. So as you make your way out and as you're looking at some of these artists, we can think particularly, it's easy to look toward the past with especially the historic items. But when looking at the contemporary ones, think about the future. And if this is where we are now, where are we going?
What about blown glass, like Preston Singleton?
Oh, yeah. I was going to say, one of my favorite artists, Ira Luhan, is doing some fantastic work as well.
That are working now in traditional form in glass.
Exactly.
I think that's
what's new is traditional, without doubt. Does anybody not get a catalog? answer that question right?
Yeah. Okay.
All right. I just thank you, Scott. I really
appreciate it. You're welcome. My pleasure.
Thank you.